So you've got a brand new Mega65, or you've got the XEMU emulator and you've got that blue screen in front of you and you just don't know what to do. Gürçe and I have you covered today as we get you started using your Mega65 along with Basic65. Now this video is purposely designed to be a rapid fire brain dump. We're going to intentionally overwhelm you, but the great thing is this is video, so you can pause, fast forward, rewind, all those things you need to do to make sure that you get the concepts in this video. So let's look at an overview of what we'll accomplish in today's quick video. First thing we're going to do is create a Hello World program. So load up that XEMU emulator or fire up that Mega65. First thing we need is a line number. We'll talk about line numbers a little bit later. Now, at the end of every basic line, you're going to hit return. All right, we have that line of code. Let's run that program, which is simply the run command, followed by the return. You have printed your first words on your Mega65. You've created your first basic program. Let's add another line of basic code. And let's run that one more time. How do I get out of there? Well, we hit the run stop key right here. And you'll see we have a break in line 10. If you want to see the program again, type list. Now let's make a few adjustments to line 10. I'm going to add a space there, and then I'm going to add the close quotations, and then I'm going to follow that line with a semicolon and hit return. What we've done is we've just made an edit to a line of code without having to retype the code using our cursor keys, followed by the return key to enter that new line replacement. So how will that differ from our previous code? Let's run it and find out. Now you'll notice that instead of just dropping vertically, hello is all over the screen. Let's break that code. Let's list that code with a list command. Now the screen's a little dirty. Let's clean that up. Let's do a shift clear home and you'll see that that clears everything off the screen. But don't worry, your code is still there. Let's add some color to the code. And I'm going to begin with a new program. So I'm going to type new. Now looking at our Google slides, I'm going to type in the Hello World program number 4. And at this point, I want to show you another feature of the Mega65. If I hit escape and 4, that will put us into 40 column mode. If I list that, you'll see that that blows up the text a little bit for us. Let's run that code and see what it looks like. Okay, that's really fast, so I'm going to slow this computer down a little bit. I'm going to hit the restore key. We're going to change the frequency back down to 1 MHz, which is more traditional with a regular Commodore computer. We're going to resume. And you'll notice that it slows that code down a little bit so that you can see the pretty colors. I can slow it down even further by holding down the Mega key. Okay, let's go ahead and break that. Now you'll notice the cursor colors, whatever color was assigned in our code when we broke the basic program. The color assignments are right on the front of the keys. If you look, you'll find that the 2 key has the white color. To get that color, we hit Control and 2. Well, wait a minute, what happened? Why didn't it turn white? It didn't turn white because there are 2 color palettes on the Mega65. Right now, it's assigned to the alternate palette. So how do we get to the standard palette? We do that by hitting Control and D, and you'll notice immediately it changes from brown to white. Now we can use that top row by hitting the Control. This should be black, white, red, cyan, and purple. So let's play around with that color palette a little bit more. Let's hit Control 1. First thing I'm going to do is turn on reversed text. Hit Control 9. Now nothing appears to happen, but watch when I press my space bar. All right, let's clear our screen. Change our cursor to black. And let's hit the space bar 3 times. Now let's do that for red. Where's red? That's on the 3. So Control 3, let's do that 3 times. All right, and finally, let's do a green, which is Control 6, and we'll hit that 3 times. So I'm going to use my cursor key, and I'm going to move down a couple of rows. We're going to use Control A to change to our alternate palette. Now let's hit Control 1, and let's go through every color. That was kind of fun, but we are not done yet. There are more colors. And now instead of using the Control key, let's hit the Mega key while we are in the alternative palette and see what happens. That's pretty slick. Let's clear our screen, let's list our program. Let's go ahead and turn reverse off. And let's talk about line numbers in basic programming. Basic 65 is a continuation of the original Commodore Basic found on early computers from the 1970s, so it's old school. As I mentioned earlier, when a line contains a line number, it tells the basic interpreter that what follows is a line of code. Every line of code is incremented by 10, so we have 10, 20, all the way up to 50. Why would I do that? Well, that allows us to insert other lines of code between lines. I would like to add a line 45. I'll hit return. Now, if I relist, you'll notice that 45 is integrated between lines 40 and 50. Now, this code will not work as it is, so I'm gonna get rid of a line of code, and I can do that by just typing 50 without anything after it. Hit return. I can list that, and you'll see that line 50 is now gone. Let's run it, and you'll see that we list hello in multiple colors. The program ends and then prints goodbye. Goodbye. But the question is, can you enter code without line numbers? You can, but that's when we use something called immediate mode. You see, we told it to print hello, it printed hello. Let's do some math. What if we want to do some hexadecimal to decimal conversion and vice versa? Let's try that. What if we want to change the color of our border? Or even our background? Well, that's not good. Let's get a color for our cursor. Speaking of the cursor, let's move it around and print some text. So the cursor command moves the cursor to specific coordinates in the XY axis and then prints from that location. Okay, I'm gonna reset the computer. Now we're gonna create our very first computer animation using PETSCII characters. We don't cover PETSCII in this video, but there's lots of information on the web about them. But we will use a couple of characters found on the front of the Q and W keys. Those are PETSCII characters, all those little characters across those alphanumeric keys. Let's use a couple of them to create a blinking light. So in line 10, we're telling the computer to first of all clear the screen. So I'm gonna hit Shift and Q, and that's going to enter that PETSCII character on the right of that key. We're gonna close our quotations, we're gonna hit return. Let's continue on. Now this command is just gonna slow the computer down for a half a second because the blink may be so fast you may miss it. And for this PETSCII character, we're going to use the Shift W. Okay, there's our basic program, let's run it. And you'll see we have a flashing dot in the upper left-hand corner that could represent all kinds of things. Congratulations, you created your very first computer animation. While that's flashing away though, let's dig a little bit more into quote mode. I'm gonna use immediate mode for a little trial and error. All right, let's type print, followed by the open quotation. That puts us into quote mode. Let's type H, let's hit the down arrow. You'll notice that when I hit the down arrow, I get a reverse Q. What does that mean? You'll find out. Let's continue on with this line. And we'll close quotes. Let's go ahead and hit return. And you'll see it prints hello in a stair-step fashion. All of those reverse Qs represents an arrow down within the print statement. Let's do another immediate line of mode, but this time add a little color to our hello. Now you remember how we added color before with the color command, now we can do it in quote mode too. There's control 9, if you remember, that turns reverse mode on. Remember, control A was our alternate palette. Control 1, which is a color code, and let's add H. And I'll continue on all the way through the word hello for you. Now, can you guess what will happen when I hit return? Let's clear the screen and talk about variables. All right, let's use immediate mode to explore our first type of variable, which is an integer variable. So what do you think will happen when I press return? That's right, it converts 1.5 into an integer variable. Let's try another one. Now this is an example of a floating point variable. What do you think will happen now? Let's do one more type of variable. Boy, the word hello is really getting a workout. What do you think will happen here when I hit return? Now we've created three types of variables in immediate mode. Guess what? They're all still there. Let me show you. So now I'm asking the computer to list all three of those variables. You can only have variable names up to two characters plus the type of variable. Here are some examples. All right, you've been waiting for it. Now we're going to create our very first game. Let's get started with putting stuff on the screen. Hey, but as you're typing, try and guess what some of the lines of code will do. You'll be surprised at how much you'll already understand based on what we've already talked about. I do want to talk a little bit about these REM statements. Those are statements that are remarks that we place within the code to tell us what that line of code does, but it does not get executed when we run the code. Now I've been typing in 40 column mode. For this program to work properly though, I need to be in 80 column mode. So I'm going to hit escape 8. Let's go ahead and run it. And there you go. We have two characters on the battlefield ready to go after each other. Let's read some user input from the keyboard so that we can move these characters around with some additional code. Let's go ahead and run stop. Let's go ahead and list our code. Let's look at the code from the Google Slides. And if you look at that code, you'll notice in the example, there are some changes. Let's get those entered in there. I need to add a line 60, so I'm going to go here and ensure that we have a way for the basic program to read the keys that we enter. Now, let's go ahead and enter that subroutine starting at 300. Now, here's a little trick. We could continue to type every line of code, or we can edit line 320, make a few changes, and every time we hit enter, we'll get a new line of code. Here's how that works. When I list, now you'll notice I have line 320 and 330, and they're both correct. All right, let's run the code and see if it works. Now, if everything is working, I should be able to hit A, S, D, and W to move a player. Let's see if it works. Look at that. I can move the character on the screen. Now, what happens if I hit that other character? And you'll just see that they're on top of each other. So what we need is another subroutine that adds some logic to the game. Let's go ahead and add that now. Quickly, you'll notice that we're adding if-then codes. If this happens, then do this. Looks good, let's run it. All right, I am being pursued. Let's see if I can move my character using my ASDW keys. And you can see it is trying to track me, and I don't think I can outrun it. Uh-oh, we broke the game logic. The game logic does not know when the cursor is off the screen. So let's talk about that. That could be some homework for you. How would you change the code to ensure that the basic program knows when the character is off the screen? What's some other homework you can do? How can we save that program? It's very simple. We type dsave, open quotations, and we give it a name. We're going to call this our chaser game. And I'm going to hit return. And you'll see that it's saved. How do we know that it's saved? We type dir, and you'll see it's saved. Now, if you want to verify that that code is also on the disk, you can do this. But what if you make a change? Say I add a line. If I hit dsave and I type chaser, watch what happens. It says file exists. You need a character in front of the file title to overwrite the existing file. We use the at symbol. That tells a Mega65 to overwrite that other file. Be careful with that. If we do a directory, you'll see it's on there. Let's list. And our line that we just added should be at the end of that listing. And it is, remember, end of program. And there you go, you have enough to be dangerous on your Mega65 programming in Basic65 to do some really fun things. Now's the time for you to experiment. We've got all kinds of links in the companion Google Slides, all the stuff down below in the video description. And by the way, if you want to learn more about your Mega65 keyboard, check out this video right here. If you just need to learn what the Mega65 is, check out this video. Hey, we'll be back with more videos, more tips and tricks. So make sure you hit like, subscribe down below. And if you really enjoyed this, hit that thanks button too. So that's it for now. RetroKat and Gürçe out.